The reconstructive ladder is a concept familiar to all plastic surgeons. The basic concept of methods of reconstruction ranked by complexity has been preserved and propagated in multiple forms. Most descriptions start with closure by secondary intention, followed by direct closure, local flaps, and distant flaps. Various authors have made finer distinctions among local, regional, and free flaps, and inserting tissue expansion somewhere in the spectrum. However, the reconstructive ladder has its limitations. Although there is virtue in using the simplest solution to a given problem, at times more complex methods of reconstruction may be preferred, even when simpler methods can achieve wound closure. To address these concerns, several modifications to the reconstructive ladder have been proposed. Mathis and Nahai suggested the reconstructive triangle, which consisted of tissue expansion, local flaps, and microsurgery. Gottlieb and Krieger introduced the reconstructive elevator, which, although still acknowledging the concept of increasing levels of complexity, suggests the freedom to ascend directly to the appropriate level if necessary. Wang and Niranjan recommended that the rungs be thought of as stages in the development of surgical skills, emphasizing that the difficulty of a reconstructive problem is related to the skill and training of the treating surgeon. Erba et al. Integrated the concepts of surgical risk, technological complexity, and surgical complexity into a matrix to help organize the various reconstructive methods and provide a framework for further discussion. However, despite its many modifications, several major advances in wound healing and reconstruction have yet to be incorporated into the latter. In particular, the use of negative pressure wound therapy and dermal matrices, both of which have achieved significant levels of clinical usage, do not fit easily into the existing paradigm. Perforator flaps, which may be either pedicled or free flaps, may also deserve some further consideration for their own rung. Conclusion. The new options can be arranged, perhaps somewhat arbitrarily, among the pre-existing options to produce that figure. Such a hierarchy is a simplificatian. Negative pressure wound therapy can be used as an adjunct to any other method of reconstruction, whereas skin grafts are virtually always used with dermal matrices and are commonly used to surface other flaps. Although perforator flaps are an evolution in flap design, their use is more a selection of technique than a reconstructive method. A perforator flap may be local, distant, or free, and perhaps unfairly, they do not lend themselves to conceptualization as a rung on that new ladder. No single best option immediately presents itself. A multitude of factors must be considered when planning a reconstruction. The nature of the wound and the condition of the patient. The functional result of the reconstruction. The skill and experience of the surgeon, the facilities and staff available in the preoperative and postoperative periods. The patient's willingness to accept a lengthy operation or weeks of wound care, and the resources available to the patient and the healthcare system that is caring for him or her, among many, many others. Attempting to create an algorithm or chart that can encompass such a decision-making process is hopeless. Rather, such judgments are at the heart of surgical decision-making. If failed free flaps in head and neck and extremity reconstruction, what is next in the reconstruction ladder? The indications for free flaps have been more or less clarified, however, the course of reconstruction after the failure of a free flap remains undetermined. Is it better to insist on one's initial choice, or should surgeons downgrade their reconstructive goals? One 8-year retrospective study showed around 3,361 free tissue transfers are done for head and neck and extremity reconstruction. A total of 101 failures, 3%, were encountered, 42 failures occurred in the head and neck region and 59 in the extremities. Evaluation of the cases revealed that one of three following approaches to handling the failures were taken. A second free tissue transfer. A regional flap transfer. Conservative management with debridement, wound care, and subsequent closure by secondary intention. In conclusion, a second free tissue transfer is, in general, a relatively more reliable and more effective procedure for the treatment of flap failure in the head and neck region as well as failed vascularized bone flaps in the reconstruction of the extremities. Conservative treatment may be a simple and valid alternative to second, free, flaps for soft tissue coverage in extremities with partial and even total loss. In this, the fourth decade of microsurgical practice, free tissue transfer have become the first choice in mandibular, breast, upper and lower extremity reconstructions, as well as in the closure of various soft tissue defects. The high free flap survival rates achieved in dedicated centers all over the world have profoundly changed the structure of the reconstructive ladder. However, because occasionally failures do still occur and are quite disastrous, the course of reconstruction after a free flap failure needs to be determined. The reconstructive options after a failed free tissue transfer have not yet been clarified, primarily because of the relatively small practice of such reconstructions and low failure rates, which make the accumulation of cases difficult. Notes. A free flap failure raises several questions regarding subsequent reconstruction. Should we insist on our initial choice and repeat the procedure or abandon our expectations for a sophisticated reconstruction and turn toward simple wound closure? Electing to perform a non-microsurgical procedure is not any less complicated because all the available options have previously found to be inadequate. A free flap failure in the head and neck region may have totally different consequences from the one in the extremities. Failure in skull base reconstruction may lead to death of a patient due to infection. Open wounds in that region are also more difficult to manage conservatively because of sanitary, cosmetic, and functional reasons. The crane principle usually doesn't work in the head and neck area because there are several cavities and the free flaps are often used to reconstruct through and through defects. The crane principle is a technique that temporarily transfers a scalp flap to the defect to deposit subcutaneous tissue. The flap is then returned to its original location, leaving behind a layer of soft tissue that is used to nourish a skin graft. A second free flap should be attempted in any case in which the failure puts the injured limb into danger. The necrotic flap overlies the major neck vessels or the wound problems have to be managed immediately to begin a life-saving radiotherapy schedule. In our opinion, the only definitive contraindication to this procedure is a patient with deteriorating general condition. Pearls. The second free flap should be designed carefully. Because of wound debridement, a little larger design may be required. The second flap should have good vascularity and longer pedicle. It is better that original recipient vessels not be used because they may have vasculitis. The anastomosis should be performed away from the problem site. Bottom line. A second free flap is not contraindicated after free flap failure, as long as the same indication remains and the patient accepts. The reconstructive ladder can be used as a stepwise progression of wound management options. 1. Secondary intention. 2. Primary closure. 3. Delayed primary closure. 4. Split thickness graft. 5. Full thickness skin graft. 6. Tissue expansion. 7. Random flap. 8. Pedicled flap. 9. Free flap.